Hey, everybody. So I am back with this crazy guest that I didn't even know who you were last time. And I put you on my show like, what, a week ago, and everybody loved you. I thought you were hilarious.
Yeah, they're going to be wildly disappointed when they get to know me better.
Well, you just have to give them enough good material that I can edit a good video together. Okay, so last time you were here, oh, and I have to tell our viewers, I promised, or well, I'd said that Celtic Iron, Mr. Pornstar, might be joining us. He also had to house sit and also dog sit. And he was making it sound pretty complicated. So I don't know if he's actually going to make it or not. But if he does, he's going to join in. If not, we'll talk to him next time.
Pornstar is not the guy I'd want house sitting for me. I've seen what they do to those houses. There's always a lady stuck in a dryer somewhere or underneath a couch. And then there's not enough Scotch guard in the world, if you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, well, I think he does a good job with these dogs.
Oh, yeah. It could also be dogs. And again, I would even think twice about that.
Oh my gosh.
No offense to your friend, but you know.
Oh yeah, no, I'm sure he's not watching this at all. He's dealing with the house sitting right now. No, but he makes Marilyn Manson videos too. So the two of us were actually like one of the, basically two of the first people to start questioning Ed and Rachel Wood's narrative. But you were on the case way before this. You were on Ilma Gore's trail years ago.
By complete accident, I'm somehow the forebearer of all of this. I tried to warn everyone, this Ilma Gore, stay away from her. And unfortunately, my pleas fell on deaf ears when it comes to Marilyn Manson. Somehow he didn't hear my cries.
Well, it was actually Evan. So, you know, Marilyn, what's funny is that Marilyn Manson, I don't think he's even met Ilma Gore. But Evan Rachel Wood is the one who's probably right now wishing that she would have stayed away. So, you know, I invite our audience to watch the previous interview that I did with you, because you talked about your backgrounds with Ilma Gore. She basically, like, you ordered a tattoo. You paid like what, like 150? Was that how much for the tattoo?
I love the idea of even trying to summarize all of the, it's like, the second you said you ordered a tattoo, this makes no sense to anyone who hasn't seen the interview. You just got to watch the interview. This lady was letting people pay to tattoo her body, and I paid her 110 bucks to get the world's stupidest tattoo, and she tried to grift me out of it. And then she also grifted a homeless children's gay kid charity or something. I don't really remember what it was.
Cool. One of the interesting things that has come out of Marilyn Manson suing her is that suddenly I've become aware of all of these different scams that this woman has been running. And it seems like she's been doing it's like a new scam every season almost.
I learned as a result of talking to you, I learned one that happened back when I was covering her and checking her out all the time that I somehow completely missed. And I talked about this on my show on Wednesday. I didn't know about the Uber driver thing. She got locked in an Uber for 2 hours. She was kidnapped. So 2016, this Uber driver, he's like, I know you. You're the lady who painted Trump with a micro penis. And she's like, yeah, that's me. You know, she thinks she's like famous now. So she's like, yeah.
Right.
Oh, yeah. Your friend is here.
Emily.
Hey, what's up?
We'll see.
I don't know. Oh, there you go. Now you can see me.
Hey, what's up?
The lights did better. Hello.
I was telling him that you're busy tonight. Well, you're doing lots of important things. How's that going?
Yeah, no, I got this. I got this beautiful bitch with me. You know what I mean?
Nice.
Yeah. Oh my God. What kind of dog is that?
I have no idea. But she's very big and expensive. And it's a heat.
Oh, it's a Weimaraner.
There you go. Yeah. Yeah. That's, he knows this stuff better than me. But yeah, this is Mozart.
Celtic, I know you may have to come in and out with the dog thing, but we were talking about we were talking about Ilma Gore, and he was and Pot Offal was talking about this story. So tell us the story one more time. I'm sorry.
That's all right. So yeah, this she gets in the Uber, and the Uber driver's like, "Wait a second, Are you that lady? Because she's so famous. Are you that lady who painted Trump with a micro penis? And then she's like, yeah, which you shouldn't say. Yeah. You know, even if you're very proud of that, you should just go, I don't know what, why would you even say that to another human being? I don't know what you're talking about. Micro penis. Yeah. You should never bring that up in public. And then the guy was like, and by, again, this is in Los Angeles, the MAGA country, as they call it. So this guy, of course, was a Trump loving patriot of these here United States of America. And I salute him for what he did. He's a hero in my eyes, because what he decided to do was he was like, you know what? I'm never going to let this bitch paint Trump again, not in a negative light. So he kidnapped her. He trapped her inside his Uber for 2 hours, just driving her around to Los Angeles as he, you know, I'm sure he was like Sig Heiling and waving to all the other dots.
As they debated furiously.
Yeah, something like that. I don't know. But it's just like such an obvious fake story. And it's right around her first Jussie Smollett story. And
the crazy thing about that is that she would claim that anybody would recognize her, that there's this crazy Trump lover who's driving around LA and recognizes Ilma Gore.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's definitely like at the front of a Trump guy's list. Number one, again, he lives in LA and he's an Uber driver. He's a Trump guy, Uber driver, LA guy. And then number two, he definitely knows who Ilma Gore is. I'm sure he, just months before that, was trying to get a tattoo on her body. I'm sure it had to have happened.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
They're all in the zeitgeist, those Uber drivers, and they're the most racist out here, particularly in LA. Yeah, that makes complete sense, that story.
Listen, I'm no mathemagician, but I can do simple arithmetic. 1 + 1 in this story equals 2. This is a true story. This passes fact or fiction. This one's fact.
Yeah. No skull fuckery in there at all.
Well, we were talking about you know, Pot Awful was already ripped off by Ilma Gore. So he was he was basically like the canary in the coal mine. He was one of the first to warn about her. But this thing is just so crazy. And I think it's insane how many people are going along with this. So you've seen the documentary, right? Pot Awful?
Yeah. Oh, well, the first part. I watched the first part. You can call me Pot. You can just call me Jesse. I'm a real guy with a real name. I said your name last time, and one of the people in the comments got really mad. He thought I was trying to dox you. He called me a creep and stuff. And I was like, I asked her beforehand what should I say? And so now I'm going to be very respectful. I'm going to say Colonel Kurtz every time. I'm going to call, I don't know Celtic's real name. I'm assuming it's not Celtic. Seems a little on the nose, by the way, that you're an Irish guy and your name is Celtic. That would be like if my name was Wonder Bread or something. You know?
Well, just I would just want, while we're on this topic, I just want everyone to acknowledge that I identify as she, her, they, them. All right. Okay.
All right. Cool. All of those. I will then, every single time I address you, I will use all 4 pronouns.
Yeah. And I like my name to be spelled out in numbers, you know, like ones and zeros.
Very
just
good.
Like I'm as intellectual and cool
like Elon
as Grimes and Elon Musk.
Exactly.
Child, exactly.
Let's see. Yeah, Celtic, tell Jesse what your first, what was it, your first name when you first got into porn that you went with?
Oh, Johnny Deep. Yeah.
Johnny Deep. What is that, your middle name in the street you grew up on?
Johnny Deep.
Yeah.
Johnny Depp.
Oh, I see. John. I call him John. John Depp. Yeah.
Oh, well, I didn't realize you guys are on a close basis like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Listen, him, my friend Bob De Niro, a lot of us, we that's how we talk to each other. Listen, no, it's like Amber Heard, but
Amber's gonna be doing porn before too long, so
there's one positive coming out of all of this.
Is that a positive? I think the testing community might have something to do with it. It's all going to get diluted significantly.
Well, that's what I meant by positive.
Oh, very good. Yeah, yeah. The not the right kind of positive in that situation. Yeah, Jesus.
The only test she'll ever pass.
Yeah, the one test she'll ever pass is where everything comes out positive. Yeah, that's hilarious. That's fucking hilarious.
So where are you right now? Are you in someone's basement shooting like basement porn, or what's going?
Yeah, this is the GIMP behind me right here.
Oh my god, I didn't even see. That's terrifying. What the fuck? I'm usually the one getting asked if I'm in a basement.
Yeah, no, I'm on the balcony.
Why do you have a statue of Anonymous?
No, it's a doll called Bob. Right, there we go.
Yeah, so
security light coming on. So I just have him dressed up in a kimono so he doesn't look as intimidating, and then I put the mask on him so that it's a little more playful.
This is one of those things where when you're on like Google Street View and you go, "What the fuck?" You know, you turn the camera on. It's like one of those anomalies.
Yeah, no, well, I think it'd be funny if I got like an ex-president's head on it, just like the film Point Blank. Or like an actual GIMP mask. I think
do not get Trump, because you will get locked in an Uber for 2 hours.
Yeah. Jesus Christ.
Well, I couldn't believe that she made up that story, but I was saying to Jesse, like, it seems like she's had a new grift like every year. Like, I've just been reading up on all of the different grifts that she has. So it seems like Evan Rachel Wood is just the latest grift that this woman has run.
She's getting better at it too, because all of her previous grifts didn't involve getting pussy as well.
Oh, I like that.
So this one's like real. This is working out for her in two different ways.
Oh my gosh.
This is kicking off here. Hang on. Easy now. You know Bobby.
Maybe he'll come back to us. Yeah. Come back to us.
You know who that is. That's Bobby.
I would also be barking if there was an anonymous statue in front of me.
You can't really see anything. Can you,
we also can't understand anything or hear each other.
You know who that is. All right, I have muted him. Wait, just a moment. Let's see. All right, he's muted.
So I'm assuming that Harvard hoodie is a joke.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. I'm gonna text him and tell him to text me when he's ready.
Okay.
What's going on? You've had like these years basically of trying to expose Ilma Gore. I mean, I know it was like a funny like joke, like a lighthearted thing, but
it started out that way, but then there was a certain point where I was actually mad.
Yeah. No, I understand. Especially since you found out that she was scamming a real charity, a real scam. But here's my question. When did you first hear this Manson stuff? And like, but what was your feeling of like, oh my God, like this is the person, you know?
I'm incredibly new to all of this. I saw somebody that I follow on Twitter retweeted Marilyn Manson's tweet about the lawsuit. That's how fresh I am to all of this. I knew, you know, vaguely through news that there were accusations against him and stuff, but I didn't follow any of it. I think I probably read like one article about it, but I never really delved into it or anything, and didn't pay any attention. And then I saw that tweet and I was like, well, that looks interesting. And I clicked the document and then I see that the defendants are Ashley Ilma Gore. And I'm like, what? It blew my mind. I'm like, no. I knew immediately. Oh, well, here's the next episode of my show. Like, stop everything. Halt production. We are switching gears here. And this is everything now. And I'm going to be following this the whole way through because I'm fascinated. And the more I learn, the funnier it gets. And watching that doc the other day with all that knowledge from the lawsuit, it's a whole other experience. I mean, I saw that they started releasing like reviews. They're, you know, the I guess they you know, lifted the embargo on reviews or whatever for it, like they'll have sometimes for movies. And so all of a sudden, all the reviews are coming out yesterday and today on Phoenix Rising. And you read them and it's like, oh, these people didn't hear. They didn't hear about the lawsuit.
No.
If they heard about the lawsuit, you can't type the stuff they're saying in these reviews and look like a real, I wouldn't say journalist. I mean, they're movie critics or whatever, but you kind of sound stupid at this point. If you watch that doc and you don't at least have some of that stuff in the back of your head and go, wait a second.
Well, and for those of us who, it was a surreal experience watching that documentary. For those of us too, who have been on this story for a long time and know that this is just, it's like such bullshit. It's like, it's just really insane. And watching, like you were saying, basically you were laughing at this, like watching the, like their setup, but like when they, you know, in the documentary, they have to move to a safe house. They say,
God, I clipped that part on in the preview version for my commentary that I did over the documentary. So that's on my YouTube channel at where. Yeah, they're moving out of their house they're moving to Tennessee from their safe house because they're afraid that Marilyn Manson and his gang of spooky kids are coming for them to beat them up or steal their hard drives, which I would assume he doesn't even know there are hard drives. I would assume if I was Marilyn Manson, if I even thought that far ahead in my head, I would go, well, there's maybe one hard drive. And then in the documentary, you see Ilma Gore stacking hard drives. Like, just buy one big one. What are you doing? Why do you have 15 hard drives? They've got a terabyte now on a hard. You can get multiple terabytes a day. All you've got is screenshots. These are like hard drives from 1998 or something. She's plugging them into a toaster. I don't know what she's doing. She's opening up the back of her laptop and undoing the parts of the laptop. And the whole time I'm going, oh, is this the hacking they were talking about? Like, what is she doing? And they've got two laptops. I couldn't get over it. This is what I said it over and over again while we were watching the doc. We did this like watch party thing where she has two laptops. One of them's up on a stand up here and the other one's down on the table. And she's like pretending like she's using both of them at the same time, switching between the two of them. It's like, what? Just use the one. You get a computer. How about that? Evan Rachel Wood must have some money. I mean, she can't be destitute. Why are you using two laptops? It's bizarre. It makes no sense. It's so clearly staged. And the worst part when it comes to staging stuff of the documentary is when they're moving out of that safe house and Ilma Gore, number one, she closes the door behind her. She's got this stack of boxes in her arms. She pretends to lock the door. You can't unsee it once you see it. We were watching it just in real time, and I'm like, wait a second. She just went like this, but she's on the outside. You don't do this on the outside. There's no key in her hand. She pretended. She just goes, bleh, like, we're not going to tell. And then she shifts the box or the boxes, and you can tell there's nothing in them. Like, you ever see a movie where they're, like, drinking coffee? They're holding, like, a coffee cup. But they're like swinging it around like this. You're like, there's nothing in that cup. You can just tell. You can just tell there's nothing in these boxes. And you would think a Hollywood actress who was working on this documentary would be able to go, oh, you know, they could actually tell. We should probably make that. They're going to be able to tell Ilma that you just pretended to lock the door. You can't mime your way through this. This isn't a 101 improv class. Is this real or are you setting this up? Like, it looks like a setup.
Everything was so staged in that. And then there's that ridiculous moment where Ilma goes to, they have an exterior shot at night out and she goes to the mini blinds and she's like peering through and then shuts the curtains. And it's
that so was ridiculous. Actually the first part I saw when I was looking at the thing, I kind of scrubbed through real quick trying to find like good parts. And that was the first thing I landed on was Ilma Gore peeking through those blinds. And I'm like, okay, this whole thing is fake then. What is she peering at? The camera guy is out there. There's no way she doesn't know the camera guy is out there. If she heard a noise and was afraid, she would be hearing the camera guy going, ah, I'm being attacked. Ah, ouchie. If any noise was happening outside, it would be the police pulling up going, hey, sir, why are you filming through that lady's blinds? What are you doing? What? Oh, you're. Oh, she told you to do that. Okay. Why is she staring out the blinds as if she doesn't know you're there? Then. Oh, okay. And then she goes and she shuts the blinds, right? And then you're like, well, wait a second. Is the camera guy supposed to just stand? Like, what is the camera guy doing? Is he now stuck outside? He's like, hey, wait a second. The door's locked. Excuse me, Ilma. Did you forget? I'm out here. I was actually filming you. Did you forget? Please let me back in. It's cold out here. Okay.
Yeah, it was so ridiculous. And the way that they even dressed alike. I mean, if you want to look like, if you want to look creepy, if you want to look like a creepy, basically a creepy psycho, like basically what they are, don't, you know, you're been yeah. dressed alike.
But they were wearing the same boots.
The same like Doc Martin looking shoes or whatever they were. They've got the leather jacket and it was hilarious. I'm going to see if Celtic is still here. I'm going to bring him back.
Okay.
Are you back, Celtic?
I am, yeah. Look at me. I'm walking out here on the Sunset Boulevard. I hope this comes through okay on the TV, but this is where it is, people. This is the strip. Me and Monta are out on a stroll. One of the neighbor girls heard him barking and came up to calm him down. Oh, and she goes, you boys should go for a walk on the strip. Take him down to Santa Monica, she said, and pull some pussy. I was like, all right, now, I mean, I don't know about that. This fella's wild, though. Look at him hunting on the hunt.
Oh, my God.
He's a big fella. But I'm sorry if he deafened both of you when he started barking like that.
No, it's all right. It's the only thing is that
Ziggy Hotel. This is Aston. This is Aston Crutcher's new hotel, the Ziggy.
Yeah, the only problem with this is that the Zoom, like whenever like there's any noise on your end, Celtic, even like exterior noise, it messes. So I don't think this is really going to work. Hey, I tell you what though, I'm editing all this, so I'm still going to have you pop in stuff in the video. So if you get in a little while, we're going to be on for like an hour. If you get somewhere where you can like talk, then great. Okay. Come back. Okay.
All right, well, just edit my headshot so that the Cartier sign is in.
So when people think of Cartier, they know to think of me. That's really important, okay? French royal jewelry, okay?
Okay, Cartier. I can do that. Celtic Iron,
one of the same. Okay. Yeah, well, I'll call you. I'm going to listen. I'll listen in, will I?
Yeah.
So I follow along?
Yeah, follow along. And then right.
I can't hear you now. You've muted yourself.
No, you haven't.
This is like Kim Kardashian.
All right, Celtic. Yeah, like, Celtic, you mute yourself now and go away.
You are going
to I can't
to
hear you, but
you're going
sights.
To have to mute him.
Tell
yourself.
Me right now, there's some sights out here on these streets. These streets, right, there's the sights of the sins of the flesh. My Lord Almighty. Oh, look, there's a couple. There's a few whores. Few girls, get a few sips in.
It's off the rails.
Get a few sips in. God bless him. All right, I can't hear you, so I guess I'm gonna hang up and listen to me fucking Bach or Chopin, and maybe a little bit of Marilyn Manson.
All right, we'll see you later. Bye bye.
All right, peace out, homies. Here, look, there's the world famous Pink Dot right behind me. Pink Dot. When you think of Pink Dots, you can think of me too as well. All right, I'm Cartier. God bless you. Peace out.
So, I mean, I think that you see that there's some potential there. We could have had...
Wrong number.
That could have been a good interaction.
Who was that guy? That was weird.
I think he misunderstood the concept of what we were doing.
He understood it completely. The assignment was take us on a walking tour of the Sunset Strip.
Are you in LA, by the way? Where are you based?
No, the moon.
The moon. Okay. Well, when I was watching your show, I watched the one that you did the day after ours, and I liked a lot of the terminology that your fans were using. Like, what they kept referring to the Dear Lord, but it was D-E-R.
Dear God, yeah. God. He's our God. Right there. There's Dear God.
Where is he?
He's right above my finger here. That's the dear God there.
Oh.
wait. There you go. There's a little Dear God action for you.
That looks like something from Eyes Wide Shut or something.
That's cool. Now I like it even more.
Are you going to have an orgy in there? Maybe we should bring my porn friend back.
You know, I have a feeling that if I were to have an orgy and that guy showed up, we'd suddenly be taking a walk down the street with a dog instead. So.
Yeah, that was a bit of an ADD infused interview there, but no. Well, one day when he's actually sedentary, we'll try to do this.
Don't hold your breath.
So I thought we would watch one of the things that we could watch is this really serious interview that Evan Rachel Wood did with Maria Shriver. Like 2 years ago when she was trying to get this Phoenix Act passed. So I guess you've caught up some on, like, you know what the Phoenix Act is, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, this piece of domestic violence legislation that she and Ilma Gore were, you know, spearheading or whatever, got some stupid politicians to jump on board and everything. But anyway, but she did this interview and, like, I think it's so, I don't know. I think it's almost like, watching like a psycho, like Sharon Stone in Basic Instinct or something, how completely like composed she is, you'll see. And this is like a far cry from her Lolita days. Like when she was with Marilyn Manson, she was like completely different person. And now we see what she's doing. So I thought we'd watch some of this and then we'll come back to it.
Okay. I'm assuming during this interview, there's very little blood raining down on her.
That's right.
I decided my story was powerful enough, and I thought that my voice could be loud enough that it could actually be heard.
Like, okay, I just wanted to say, like, I look at her, I look at the way that she is right here, like this pantsuit that she's wearing.
She's dressed like Hillary.
She is. That's exactly it. That's like, she's trying to conjure this. It's like, it's so obvious with this woman that she is totally lost in these roles that she's playing. I don't know if you remember from the documentary, when the first 30 minutes they're talking about her and they're just talking about how she couldn't distinguish fantasy from reality because she grew up with this crazy dad and this crazy family and everything.
Well, she imagined her vagina as an octopus, which I found a little confusing too.
What was that about? Like putting that in there?
I mean, listen, I already said this, but if your vagina looks like an octopus, Marilyn Manson's gonna fuck it. So you can't really be mad about that.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Are you popping back in for a minute?
I'm popping back in because I'm in Beverly Hills and it's very quiet. So I just took a left off Sunset Boulevard down to Santa Monica. So like I have a mile and a half before it gets loud again. And I thought, just since you guys are such great company, you know, this is the highlight of my Saturday night.
Are you near Marilyn Manson's castle right now? Could you go there and SWAT him?
Oh my God. Well, we have, we've been talking a lot about Ilma Gore, but
I like her face tattoos. I mean, it takes away from her eyes, you know,
which is only a good thing really. Cause
right,
the eyes are the windows to the soul. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
you can see the fire burning.
Since you guys have brought up the way she looks, like, this is my question. You know, Evan Rachel Wood, whatever we may think of her, she's an attractive woman, and she's this really wealthy Hollywood star. Like, what?
Well, I used to think she was attractive till I found out that her vagina was Cthulhu.
For those of you that don't know what Cthulhu is, it's a tentacle octopus.
That's exactly right. We were talking about how the first part of the documentary of Phoenix Rising, she talks about how she thought that when she was a girl, she thought her vagina was ugly. And then they show these tentacles coming out of her.
Yeah, that was funny. That was funny. The cartoon, the illustrator for that was hilarious. But every girl thinks their vaginas are ugly, just like every boy thinks his dick is small. You know what I mean?
I never thought that. That's
you're a lot more confident than me, good sir. You know?